What's going on YouTube? It's your boy Midas here, and today I'm going to be building my very own NAS. So my network attached storage, that's what NAS stands for. So basically what it's gonna do is help in storing all of my 4K videos, my photos. It's even gonna act as my home media center. So it's gonna host all of my movies and stuff like that. To my left right here, I've got an old PC that I built about 2 years ago, maybe three now, so about two to three years ago. And I built it for, you know, just some personal use, nothing crazy, just, you know, a middle of the line kind of a PC, nothing over the top, not no gaming PC or nothing like that. This right here is a Roswell server chases. And the reason why I've got this Roswell server chases is because when you're trying to build a home server, the number one thing you have to think about is the casing. So this casing, this traditional, you know, conventional style casing, they're not designed, you know, to hold server builds. You know, if you build, because a server is a PC, it's all it is. It's nothing, you know, different from a regular PC. The kind of case that that PC goes into and the OS that that, you know, PC runs is what makes it a server. So we're going to be running the on-RAID software on, you know, this PC build when I transfer all the different things that I'm gonna take out of this old PC and put it into this new PC case. So this case can hold up to 8 HDD drives. And that's the most important thing you have to consider when getting a case for a server build. It has to be able to hold, you know, a good amount of storage and have the opportunity to be expanded. You know, expansion is important because your server keeps growing. It never really just stays the same. The server provides cloud storage, you know, like think Google Drive, think Dropbox. So think of having your own personal version of those, you know, cloud storage options. That's what you can do with your own NAS storage. You can access all these different things from anywhere, and you can increase the storage as you need. That's the cool thing about it. So it's very customizable, and it's cool to have, especially if you're like me and you, you know, work with lots of large files. So what I want to do right now is build my own version of a storage, you know, something that I can use for storing my 4K videos and my 4K photos, or just high quality photos, as well as, you know, something that's going to act as my media center. Also got a few things in front of me here. I'll just let you guys know what they are. This is a 120 millimeter fan from Noctua. These two right here, I've got five of these, by the way. And then there's two smaller ones here. They're 80 millimeter fans, also from Noctua. Because I've heard the fans in, you know, this Roswell case, they're not the best. That they're basically archaic. When you're working with tons of HDDs in one space, you know, tons of storage devices always working, then it's going to run hot a lot. So get quiet fans that are nice and work very well. Inside this Samsung case, I've got a 1 TB NVMe SSD, so for fast storage. Right here, I've also got my ASUS 10 gigabit network card. So this is going to allow me transfer data very quickly. Right here, I've got two HDD drives, Seagate Iron Wolf, you know, that's all it is. So these drives are gonna be really good for, you know, the storage, because they're 12 terabytes each. So let's go ahead and see what's in here. Pull out these parts, and then I'll open this up, and then we'll start to build inside this PC case.
Reckless talk. Son of a justice. Hey, reckless talk.
Okay, so that's all the old stuff that we took out of the old PC. They're a little dusty, so I'm gonna go ahead and use this cool 2-in-1 air duster and vacuum. So you can find this down in the description if you're interested. You should also use a cloth to clean when you're working, so not just the air duster. Okay, now I've got the Roswell case. I'm just gonna take off the side so I can go ahead and install all the parts. Okay, out with the old and in with the new. Look at that style of cable. Like, I don't know. I don't mess with that. I like the new style, so the smaller ones.
Expensive habits. Don't step in soul. I'm a real one. Check my fabric. Hey, I said reckless talk, but I got expensive habits. Don't step in soul. I'm a real one. Check my fabric. Look at my fabric. I add this Atlas. I point way up. I got a passion mixed with action. Boy, don't play. Look at my fabric, I add this Atlas, I point way up. I got a passion mixed with action, boy, don't play us. Look at my fabric.
During the process, after moving the old parts into the new, you know, PC case and installing all the additional parts, all the extra parts, the PC decided not to turn on. So something was wrong. I decided, oh my God, here we go again, you know, because I've dealt with this kind of stuff when building Windows PCs where it just won't start, you know, off the rip. So sometimes you have to tweak something, something's not seated correctly, or a PC part is bad, or it's not supplying enough power. There's so many different reasons that it could be, but you have to kind of diagnose it by using the process of elimination. So what I did was, for all of the new parts, I didn't really change anything. I just kept them as is, because honestly, new parts have less of a chance to be bad as the old parts. I'm not saying they can be bad. There's some DOA items that I've received personally, but it's not common. You know, at least not for me. I've not really experienced, you know, DOA like lots. Dead on arrival is what DOA means, by the way. So the first part that I eliminated were the RAM sticks. I went ahead and picked up some new RAM sticks from Amazon just to quickly, you know, see if the RAM sticks that I have on there were bad, because the code on the motherboard kept stopping at the RAM spot. So I assumed that was the problem. So when I switched out the RAM sticks, it came on once. For 1 second, it just came on and it was done. It didn't come back on the next time I tried it. I changed absolutely nothing. Like I said, PC, sometimes you can't really understand what's going on until you keep, you just gotta keep trying. So next up, I went ahead and picked up a motherboard to replace the one that was already on there. So the micro ATX motherboard, I replaced it with an ATX motherboard, something larger with more power and, you know, has more slots. I was going to eventually upgrade this piece, so I said I might as well grab it now if the motherboard is broken. As soon as the motherboard arrived, I went ahead and switched out the old one, the micro ATX, for the new one, the ATX. And I plugged everything else in, you know, the way they're supposed to be. I used the old RAM sticks, not the new ones. I put those to the side. And I used all the other parts, the CPU from the old PC, the graphics card from the old PC, you know, all the stuff, the NVMe, SSD, and everything else. I plugged them all on there, and then I tried to power it, and it just won't power. So I kept struggling and wondering what, you know, the problem was in this case, and I thought it was the power switch, the cable that connects between the power button on the case and the power on the motherboard. So I kept tweaking and switching and trying to figure out what was going on there. It just wouldn't power. The motherboard would light up. It would have some like little light, you know, getting some passive electricity. So it was getting powered, but it just wasn't getting enough power. I don't think it was. So at this point, I started thinking that the motherboard was dead on arrival. So a DOA part. And I was starting to get pissed, you know, get angry at this point. Like, come on, this is the second part I'm switching. I might as well build a whole new PC at this point, you know? But then it hit me and I thought to myself, it looks like the entire system just isn't getting enough power. And logically, when you think about it, I've now added a ton more parts than what was there before. So I had a 550 TX or a TX550 from Corsair. So only provided 550 wattage of power. And when I initially built the old PC, I hadn't considered that I would, you know, need to expand it and add all these different parts. I'm running, you know, multiple drives off the same system, running, you know, a 10 gigabit LAN port, running, you know, graphics card, RAMs, and possibly expanding from there. Honestly, I was also working with a smaller board that was, you know, pulling from that power source. So I thought to myself, you know what, let's try changing the power source completely. Let's try, you know, feeding this entire system with more power. So at that point, I was switching out the third part from the old PC. So I was like wondering, like, at this point, I might as well build an entirely new PC. So I upgraded from a TX550 to the RM850X. So this one's rated 80 plus gold. It provides 300 watts more power than the, you know, 550 that I had there initially. So I quickly installed that, you know, swapped them out. All I had to do was push the power button once. Everything in the entire system lit up. It just seemed like this was the missing piece of the puzzle. And I was extremely excited that it was finally done. All that was left at this point was completely setting up the Unraid servers, you know, so allocating disks for, you know, different purposes, setting up my home media server so I can watch movies from whatever part of the house from my media center. So you just download movies and you can put them on your server and then watch them like Netflix. So you can create your own version of Netflix, basically, which is super cool in my, you know, opinion. I had some help from my brother. He's really, really good with this kind of stuff, you know, network servers and stuff like that. So he's already got one going on. He's actually the reason why I decided to, you know, build my own NAS server, because I honestly wouldn't have cared too much about a NAS server. I would have kept languishing, you know, using external hard drives, which honestly is terrible. You know, it's just too much work having to plug them in and bring them around. It's just, and it piles up, it adds up. And if you lose one, it's just gone. It's broke, everything's gone. But with this system, you can create backups and whatnot, and it's all on, you know, your local network. So it's on a server, a different PC is dedicated to storing all of your, you know, heavy contents. I'm gonna take this down into the basement and I'm going to just set it down there for now. I intend to build an entire server rack soon. So I'm gonna have a few more things there which I'll talk about, like my security system for my home. I'm gonna show you guys how I'm, you know, gonna set it up using this server. That way I have access to video footage and stuff like that all the time. At the end of the process, I learned a lot more about building PCs and troubleshooting problems. And this is just what happens. Experience is the best teacher. You learn a lot the more, you know, you do things, the more you live, you know, the more you engage in stuff. But out of all of those parts, I ended up getting rid of the motherboard because the one I got was only $20 maybe or $30 more than the one that was already there. And honestly, I wanted more power. I'm eventually going to have to upgrade the system, so I just said I might as well keep the motherboard. So the motherboard didn't seem like it was a problem. The main culprit was the power supply, so that had to be changed 100%. But the motherboard didn't have to be changed, as well as the RAM stick. So I didn't change the RAM sticks. I used the RAM sticks from the old PC, and I used the CPU as well as the GPU from the old system. So all I changed, all I added into the new system was the case. Something else I changed was the motherboard, which I just talked about. Moved from micro ATX to ATX. Something else I changed were the fans in the case, because the fans that were initially in there were very archaic and loud. You guys probably can't hear it because this entire system is just, it's been going this entire time and you can't hear anything. It's a super quiet system and I love it. I love all parts of it so far. Another thing that I've added to the system is a 10 gigabit LAN port. So this 10 gigabit LAN port is going to allow for faster data transfers. And since this is a server, that's extremely important. I need data to move quickly between different, you know, paths. For storage, I have two SATA drives. So they're the slowest kind of drives you'll find out there. There's SSDs, there's NVMEs, but those are very pricey. So get in like 12 terabytes of that. Good luck with, you know, the pricing on that. It's gonna be crazy, is what I'm saying. And mechanical drives are better for, you know, storing a bunch of just stuff that you don't access all the time, infrequently accessed files. And finally, for this DIY build, I've got a 1 terabyte NVMe SSD. So a cache pool is going to hold things like my Plex server, you know, things like virtual machines, like Windows, basically things that are graphic intensive, like apps and store and stuff like that. So if you do work from home, that requires, you know, you having to store a lot of footage, save a lot of files and all of that, having a home server might be something that you want to consider. So if you're looking to build your own home server, I'd like you guys to comment down below if you have any questions about it, about the process, about what I went through to build mine. I hope you guys have enjoyed this video. If you did, you already know what to do. Make sure to hit that like button down below. Subscribe if you're new to the channel. Hit the bell icon if you're new to the channel as well, so you can be notified whenever I post brand new videos. I will catch you guys in my next video. It's Midas, and I'm out, y'all.